A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the Pharisees, "There was a rich man who dressed up in purple garments and fine linen and dined sumptuously each day. And lying at his door was a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who would gladly have eaten his fill of the scraps that fell from the rich man's table. Dogs even used to come and lick his sores. And when the poor man died, he was carried away by angels to the bosom of Abraham. And the rich man also died and was buried, and from the nether world, where he was in torment, he raised his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. And he cried out, 'Father Abraham, have pity on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am suffering torment in these flames.' Abraham replied, 'My child, remember that you received what was good during your lifetime, while Lazarus likewise received what was bad. But now he is comforted here, whereas you are tormented. Moreover, between us and you, a great chasm is established to prevent anyone from crossing who might wish to go from our side to yours, or from your side to ours.' He said, 'Then I beg you, Father, send him by my father's house, for I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they too come to this place of torment.' But Abraham replied, 'They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them.' He said, 'Oh no, Father Abraham, but if someone from the dead goes to them, then they will repent.' And Abraham said, 'If they will not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded if someone should rise from the dead.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. Well, you know, when you hear this amazing story, well, every time I hear this amazing story about Lazarus, and every time I hear the name Lazarus, right away I think of my hero, the great Pope John Paul II, when he came to New York, October 2nd, 1979, he was up in Yankee Stadium, and he spoke some very dramatic words about this thing. Jesus has given us a very dramatic teaching, you know, about poor, about rich, about hungry people, people who have enough. And, you know, we got to do something, you know. And you can say, well, this thing makes me really feel guilty because, you know, the guy's talking from the flames burning in the torment of hell, and then he's trying to help his brothers, and he really can't help his brothers, so I don't want to do that, so I better do something. Well, true, we better do something. But, you know, it's not just about doing something, because then we reduce the tension of having, have not. And it goes across the board, because you can have a lot of food, you can have a lot of money, and you can still suffer poverty. You can still be a Lazarus laying at the doorstep of your own husband or wife, friend, brother, in-law, outlaw, family member, stranger, choir member, priest, parish, here, there, everywhere. So it really doesn't matter, because we're actually all in the same boat. It's just a little bit different. And, you know, John Paul, when he was in Yankee Stadium, October 2nd, 1979, he said, "The parable of the rich man and Lazarus, the gospel of today, must always be present in our memory. It must form our conscience." He also said when he was there that Jesus makes us sharers in what he is. Because if we don't see this whole thing differently, we might not see it at all. We might see it wrongly. And not just the problem of rich, poor, hungry, not hungry. You know, because there's a lot of hungry people in the city. There's a lot of hungry people in the world. What do you do? We can't do everything for everybody, but we got to do something for somebody. You know, I mean, it ain't nothing like a little, you know, if we prepare ourselves ahead of time, especially, you know, well, somebody's going to come up to me sometime. And even if we're unprepared, to have something to give them, because I'm not necessarily a believer in just give them a dollar, shut them up, and let them go away. Here's a dollar, go get a piece of pizza. You know, many times people say to me, Father, I'm hungry, and I'm next to a pizza place. I say, you want a slice? I don't want to eat now, I want to eat later. I say, oh, one of those. Okay, well, look. And then I ask them their name. I said, well, I'll pray that you get something later, and I pray that you take my slice of pizza right now if you're really hungry. And then, you know, you walk away, but you give them your attention. You give them your time. It ain't nothing like a couple of $5 McDonald's little gift cards can handle. Put a little peanut butter crunch, I don't know, Nutribar in your pocketbook or in your pocket or something like that. And they might say, I don't like that. You're offering them something. It's not a problem to solve. The poor are not problems to solve. Our poverty is not a problem to solve. The poverty of war, all the big stuff, all the little stuff, all the spiritual stuff, the emotional stuff, the financial stuff. Poverty in its grandest landscape can be reduced to a problem to solve, which is tragic. But then if it's not a problem to be solved, then what is it? What can we gain from what Jesus is trying to teach us? Well, I mean, we can be equipped and we can be armed. You have to be careful because you can't just go up and be friendly and to everybody without being cautious. We need a little bit of street smarts mixed into the salad. A little salt, a little pepper, a little parmesan, a little garlic, a little street smart. But not to the point that we're afraid, but we don't want to be stupid, right? And maybe have a little a little McDonald's card or a little something. And if somebody don't want it, you say, hi, okay, well, thank you. You give them the prayers and we put ourselves at risk of being misunderstood. I had people spit at me. I had people say all kinds of things to me. Hallelujah. I wipe it off and just carry on and go, you know. But what could it be that Jesus is trying to teach us here with this thing? And especially when you hear in the second reading, say, Paul to Timothy, in terms of being a man of God, pursue righteousness, devotion, faith, love, patience, and gentleness. And this is where that famous line in verse 12 comes, fight the good fight. I'm sure you probably heard that before. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you are called, because the consequences are grave. They're really grave, but Jesus is trying to get us to what Papa Francesco refers to as a culture of encounter. Jesus is trying to get us somehow to see in a new and a fresh way, not only the possibility, but the necessity to create a culture of encounter. In the midst of the difficulties and the impossibilities of not only the hungry people in our streets, in our neighborhoods, in our world, in our country, but the deeper levels of poverty and hunger. And when Papa Francesco was in Rio de Janeiro with the young people for World Youth Day in July, earlier this year, he said to the young people there, and he says to us, to the whole church, be servants of communion and of the culture of encounter, because we can create a counterculture of avoidance. I don't want to look at nobody. I don't want to see nobody. I want to get these people out of my neighborhood. And sometimes we might have to move people out of our neighborhood. Sometimes life takes a turn where we have to make some dramatic changes. Not that we would want, then come by necessity. And then sometimes we got to make very difficult choices. It's not denying that. That's not the point. But the point is, when we want to create a culture of avoidance rather than a culture of encounter, I think that's at least one of the things that Jesus is trying to teach to us. And Papa Francesco says, I would like you almost to be obsessed about this, to create a culture of encounter. And he says, be so without being presumptuous, imposing our truths, but be guided by humble yet joyful certainty of those who have been found, touched, and transformed by the truth of Christ. And during this year of faith, it's really important for us. I mean, the year of faith is going to end. October's right around the corner. And then boom, November's going to be here. The solemnity of Christ the King, the year of faith, is finito. But the year of faith is intended to create a new fire burning. So that, as Papa Francesco said in the encyclical, Lumen Fide, so that we can find a new way of seeing. Papa Francesco and Pope Benedict tells us in this encyclical, because it's written by two popes, faith does not merely gaze at Jesus, because we can say, yeah, Jesus is really truly present in the poor, and he is. You say, well, I haven't seen him there yet. Well, that's all right, keep looking, because he ain't going nowhere. Faith does not merely gaze at Jesus, but get this, faith sees things as Jesus sees them, with his own eyes. It is a participation in his way of seeing. And you know what? That's 2013, 34 years ago, 1979, Yankee Stadium, the great Caro Votiwa, blessed, soon to be Saint, Pope John Paul II. You know what he said? The church looks at the world through the very eyes of Christ. That's what we got to do. Because if we don't do that, you know what we're going to do? We're going to get stuck. And I got news for you. I'm the last person I want to be stuck with myself. And it happens many times a day. But as many times as I get stuck, Jesus gives me a way out. With me, with all the geniuses, that's what I call them out there when we drive. Do you drive? If you don't drive, somebody drives. Well, bus driver, cab driver, this driver, that driver. What do they drive you? They drive you crazy. They drive me crazy, maybe not you. But Jesus gives me a way out. Because he helps me to see with his eyes. If I see with his eyes, then maybe I begin to think with his mind. And if I can see with his eyes and think with his mind and love with his heart, then, like a really wise Polish bus driver said to me one time when I was in Poland on the bus with this bus driver, he said, in Poland, every problem, no problem. I said, wow, in Poland, every problem, no problem. Forget Poland. What about New York? Forget New York. What about me? No matter where I go, whether it's Lazarus at my doorstep, whether it's you or somebody else, or even if it's everybody, things might be so bad that forget Lazarus. Everybody's like Lazarus to me. Then everybody, everywhere, will be the opportunity for love. I think that's at least one reason why Jesus says what he says. And I can tell you that that's the absolute reason why Jesus does what he does. Which is why we're going to stand and profess our faith. So that we can really believe that it's him who comes down in a piece of bread. And so that we can really believe that it's him in the Lazarus that we encounter everywhere, every day. Amen.